I don't know where to start. Should I talk about how much I miss everyone? Should I talk about the proper sleep I haven't had in weeks? Should I talk about the fire burning in my chest, scared to burst out on the wrong person? Should I talk about my home to the people who don't really care and just ask to be polite? Should I just keep everything bottled up and act like everything is okay? Should I continue living my life here while everybody is fighting so hard there? Should I buy a plane ticket and never look back? Should I throw my life away and go fight for my home? Should I listen to my mother's advice and not do anything too reckless? Should I stop wasting my time and energy worrying so much? I don't know where to start. Should I even start?
When you're Lebanese and a first-generation American, you're never really American. Your food is Lebanese, your language and your math and your manners are Lebanese, your friends are Lebanese, your parents' friends are Lebanese. Your music is Arabic, and two-stepping looks different when we get together. Your hospitality is Lebanese. Your hair is too. Your curse words are Arabic, as are your prayers, because some things just don't have the same feeling in English. When you grow up Lebanese in America, you're never really American. Until you are. Until you're watching your capital explode on your fully charged smartphone, until you're scrolling through Instagram posts, laying in bed after a hot shower, until you're listening to the news on the way to the job that you still get to go to, until you come home to a hot meal that didn't cost half your paycheck. It's hard to explain this feeling. The feeling of being too whole to be broken.
Growing up as part of Lebanon's first post-war generation, we were brought up with our parents' fears and mistrusts. Fear that war can erupt at any time, mistrust in the government, a skeptical view of the future, but mainly an understanding that life can change from one day to the next, and to never take things for granted. Although we lived in a time of relative peace, we did experience some of the trauma we had only been told about for so many years. Bombs going off in the middle of the night, families being separated, political unrest. Yet we made it through and started rebuilding. I was one of the lucky ones. I made it out and went abroad. I thought I had put some of it behind me, but quickly realized that being a Lebanese expat came with its own breed of troubles. Lebanon has a way of calling for you, reeling you back in, only to spit you right back out. And that fosters the most intense love-hate relationship you can imagine. You love to love it. You hate to love it. You love to hate it. And you hate to hate it. It's a complex paradox. But it is our paradox.
I am grateful I have everything, but still, I cry. I have everything, but still, I feel empty. I have everything, but still, I feel worthless. I am far, and still, I live trying to be close. I am far, but still, I feel guilty. I have everything, but still, I feel powerless. I have everyone, but still, not my people. I have everyone, but still, not my family. I have everyone, but still, I feel lonely. They've pushed me away from you. Home was in your streets, in your arms. They ask me, why are you so obsessed? I cry, because they'll never understand.
You are good. You are brilliant. You are beautiful. You open your arms to few and to many, from far away and from near. Despite it all, I have hope. Hope that there will be an end to this nightmare. Hope that we will no longer see ourselves as Sinni, Shia, Druze, Maronite, Orthodox, but that we will see ourselves as being more than our predetermined beliefs. That we will see ourselves as people. People who have gone through the same hardships. People who are on the ground day in and day out. People who are being betrayed and beaten down by the very government meant to protect us. Justice needs to be served. You know who you are. You know what you have done. You won't break us. With every theft, we become stronger. With every killing, we become stronger. With every bomb, we become stronger.
Let me tell you about my summer fling. Every year around June, we meet and it's like the first time all over again. We walk, then we talk, then we walk some more, always gravitating towards the seashore. We talk about politics and how the world belongs to its critics, and how if things were different, we would know no distance. But our story is one of love and loss. We were separated very young by family who thought we didn't belong. They said we could never be because our relationship had nothing to offer me. No career, no ambition, no safety. The classic story. So, every year, I wait for our only time to be. That is one thing they'll never take away from me. We would spend our days at the beach, or walking on the corniche, or stuffing our bellies with spreads of meze, ara, and manaish. Sheesh. The sunsets are sacred. Lots of pictures and my breath are taken. I take a deep breath, take it all in, aware that my summer fling is coming closer to its end. With every passing sunset, every summer, I reconnect with a part of me that, for 10 months out of 12, is mostly intact. I find my roots and think of all the roots that would lead me back to you. My beautiful Beirut. I think about how much I need you and how much you need me, and how this is the sweetest summer fling to ever be.
Beirut is not a city. It is a feeling, a sensation that starts at the pit of your stomach when you catch a glimpse of it through the airplane window and grows in a turbulent frenzy. Beirut is not a city. It is the smells on the street of freshly baked bread, satad, coffee, exhaust fumes, and a long lingering scent of pine trees that no longer dwell there. Beirut is not a city. It is a bosom of belonging where the tailor asks after your mother, the plumber worries about your leaky faucet, and the grocer sends his regards to your grandfather as you cross the street. Beirut is not a city. It is your first word, your first step, your first kiss. It is the endless nights on the streets, and the memories that still make you smile all these years later. Beirut is not a city. It is the freedom for thinkers to debate, poets to recite, and storytellers to narrate. Beirut is not a city, it is a body that bullets have ravaged time and time again, tearing through it rock, stone, flesh, and bone. Beirut is not a city, it is a people, touched by magic and molded by resilience. Beirut is not a city, it is the legend of the phoenix. Beirut is not a city, it is the beating heart inside me.
Thank you. Je reviens. Te dire que tu es belle. Te dire que tu me manques. Et que je ne t'oublie pas. Je reviens. Te chanter des chansons. Crier mille fois ton nom. Et dormir dans tes bras. Je reviens. Te consoler un peu. Te faire rire si je peux. Et rêver avec toi. Je reviens. Et si mille fois encore, tu auras besoin de moi, je reviendrai pour toi.
To everyone who left, to everyone who is about to leave, to every person who took a plane out of Beirut to somewhere, anywhere, just anywhere but here, to every person who held tears back for hours as they said their goodbyes, until they finally could let them out once they were alone on the plane, to every person who waved goodbye at the airport to their family and friends, and turned around to walk towards the gate with eyes so watery they couldn't see. To every person who cried as they held their loved ones in their arms for the last time, not knowing when and if they will be able to see them again. To every person who left but never wanted to leave.
Ne te justifie pas si tu pars. Ne te justifie pas, parce que tu as le droit de vivre une vie normale. Tu as le droit de l'offrir à tes enfants. Tu as le droit de construire ton avenir, d'accomplir tes rêves. Ne te justifie pas si tu pars. Pars! Pars!
To every person who walked away when all they wanted was to stay. To every person who dreams of the day they will leave, when all they had ever hoped for was to build a decent future here. To every person who feels stuck in a cage boiling with sadness and rage. To every person who cannot leave. To every person who doesn't want to leave. To every person whose loved ones all gradually left. To every person who feels lonely, alone with so many painful memories. To every person who cries at night, picturing what their life could have been like. To every person who breathes and still hopes for a better future. To every person who is finding it hard to breathe and has trouble seeing a future.
Déploie tes ailes pour nous. Va, respire un air plus doux. Ne te justifie pas si tu pars. Parce que nous aurons besoin de toi. Ta famille qui reste aura besoin de toi. Notre combat pour retrouver notre pays aura besoin de toi. Notre guerre contre ces criminels n'est pas finie. Nous avons besoin de soutien, du soutien des expatriés, de leur pression sur ceux qui veulent vraiment nous aider.
To every person trying to justify their choice to others or to themselves, to every person who is spending days and nights dwelling on a decision, I want you to know that it is not a decision any human being should ever have to make. To leave or to stay.
Ne te justifie pas si tu pars. Comme ne te justifie pas si tu restes cloîtré chez toi. Chacun d'entre nous gère comme il peut la douleur. Chacun d'entre nous essaye de panser ses plaies et les plaies des autres.
You don't need to justify your answer. And there is no good answer. The two choices are the color of pain. They're really only two different shades.
Stop romanticizing resilience. We don't want to be resilient. The sight of children and youth cleaning up the debris is heartwarming, but is mostly a reminder that we don't even have the luxury to mourn. Why isn't the army deployed to assist in relief efforts? Why should we be the ones looking for factories to take the glass debris? Thousands of people roaming streets near the explosion site, and no one even bothered to measure the radiation levels. Are we breathing poison? Why do we have to be the government, the victims, and the survivors in every crisis. We are no longer resilient. We are angry and full of rage, and we will take revenge.
لبنان حبي الأول والأخير ببعد عنه بشتقله بسكن فيه بزعل منه آخر صيفية بلبنان طالت سنة ونص ثورة كورونا وانفجار ثورة هي سلاحنا ضد الفساد والإجرام كورونا فيروس قتل القوي والضعيف وتالت أكبر انفجار بالعالم كتار ماتوا كتار انجرحوا كتار تشردوا نص بيروت اتدمرت كيف اتخلى عنك يا بيروت الجريحة عن شعبي المقهور عن عائلتي المشردة كيف اتخلى عن ثورة حق ووجود ونضال للعدالة؟ كيف اتخلى عن بناء وطن نعيش فيه بكرامة وحرية؟ ما ناقصني شي بالغربة بس عذاب وقهر وحنين للوطن المريض قصتك يا بيروت كتير حزينة بس قلوب ولادك مليانة أمل بالانتصار على الظالم على الخاين وعلى المجرم
We will always see. We will always see your disturbed mental health, dishonesty, hypocrisy, so-called democracy, bureaucracy, and the ultimate forged generosity. Your unreal acts, depictions, and pretentious mockery, your embezzlements, vandalism, extortions, and treason. We will always see and look and observe and spot and watch and stare and gaze and notice and witness your fabricated lies. We will always see the deception and betrayal that you have brought upon us. We will always see whether you attack us, harm us, damage our homes, fight our souls, or impair our sight. We will always see your deprived spirits drifting here and there because that's all you will ever do. Because you will always be blind. You will choose to be blind even when it's bright and clear, even when it's rainbows and sunshine, even when colors strike your filthy faces, you will be blinded by them. You won't be inspired. Why? Because your blindness is inattentional and willful. Your brain cells are so contaminated with the idea of power they no longer function. And that's why you choose to be blind, and you will always be blind. Blind to freedom, liberty, love, devotion, responsibility, commitment, unity, order, serenity, and peace. You will only see war, corruption, bribery, theft, fraud, crime, delinquency, injustice, failure, and death. And that is why we will always see, as for you, you will remain blind for life.
How do we pack our love for Beirut, the city that mesmerized us and broke our hearts simultaneously, into suitcases and boxes and bear to walk away again? What we're building today is for our kids and future generations, so that one day, if they choose to leave Lebanon, they can wave their Lebanese passport with pride and tell the story of how their parents were part of the revolution that changed everything.
This is for all the suitcases that had to be packed.
The short-lived romance with the city. The frustrating time difference.
And the torn-up plane tickets.
This is for everyone who left,
counting the days to be back home.
Home. Oh, how I just cannot wait to step foot in my homeland. It seems as if all expats are experiencing the same type of nostalgia, one that is completely uncertain of what to expect. Complete heartbreak for what is happening to a piece of land which never even asked for this type of torture, never did anything to deserve it. It's totally disrupted and disturbed. Families, lovers, young ones, all needing to feel held by the rich culture that will never leave our beings. Why does humanity have to be so ugly, so disturbing, yet always holding a glimpse of beauty? No matter how many years go by, I will always and forever yearn for a life in my homeland. To have all my loved ones back in their homes, surrounded by their loved ones, all enjoying each other's company under the sun, in the coffee shops, in the bars and clubs, dancing our souls away, having conversations while chain-smoking our lungs away, because why not? Sitting in a spot overlooking breathtaking views that still shock us that this is where we get to call home.